Yes. Good morning, everybody, and for those of you that are online, good morning to you too. I was supposed to be speaking next week, and I got a message this morning from my son-in-law saying, "I'm very sorry that the preacher cancelled and made you work on Mother's Day." Anyway, Mother's Day it is, and I'm really, really pleased that I can stand here this morning as a very proud mum, because it was my daughter and my granddaughter that started the service off this morning. The title of my message is called Right Time, Right Place. I know there's always a right time and right place for everything, isn't there? And how many times have we actually said, "Wow, I got a real bargain because I was at the right place, right time"? Well, let me tell you this morning, there are so many instances in the Bible where the right time and the right place were poignant. We're going to start with looking at Noah. Well, he listened to God, didn't he? When all those around him thought that he was nuts. You know, he was told he'd got to build an ark and he'd got to build it this size. And then he was telling people there was going to be a flood. Right time, right place. They all thought he was bonkers. But you know, right time, right place, God knew, didn't he? And it was the right time and the right place. And I'm sure they all realised that when the floods came and they were lost. So look at Jonah, Nineveh. And God wanted Jonah to go to Nineveh for something that he knew was really special and was very much needed. And Jonah was so frightened that he decided he wasn't going to go. So he was going to jump on board ship and he was going to go somewhere else, and that was it. He could hide from God. Well, you know, it doesn't matter where we are, we can't hide from God. You know, you might stick your head under the blanket so that other people can't see you, but God can still see you. It doesn't matter where you are. And then we hear that the ship was shipwrecked. Well, where was Jonah going to go? Was he going to drown? No, God had got another plan for him, hadn't he? And he was swallowed by a huge fish. We assume it was a whale. We don't really know. It just said a large fish. Where did that fish spit him out? Nineveh. That's exactly where God wanted him. So he arrived in Nineveh, right time, right place. John 3:8 reads, "The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, 'Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone each woman. Now, what do you say?' They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write in the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, 'Let any one of you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone at her.' Again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, 'Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?' 'No one, sir,' she said. 'Then neither do I condemn you,' Jesus declared. 'Go now and leave your life of sin.'" Once again, right place, right time. We're learning that God's timing is always perfect. And we know that, don't we? And I'm sure that many of us have had instances in our own lives where right time, right place. And we've known that that was God. How many of us have ever thought to cast the first stone? How many of us have been ready to talk about wrongs of others? How many of us? You know, and I'm asking this question because I'm guilty of this. You know, you get drawn into conversation sometimes, don't you? And you then think, "Oh yeah, they did this. Do you remember?" Well, it's wrong of us to think like that, isn't it? It's wrong, you know? And I said something to my granddaughter this morning, and she said, "Grandma, no. You say you forgive, you forget, and you walk away." And we were only in jest, but you know, those words are so true. We should forgive and forget. And it's no good saying, "Oh, I'll forgive you, but I'll never forget what you did." Because that's not what God wants of us, is it? He wants us to forgive and to forget. And you know, when we ask his forgiveness, he forgets what the sin was. Luke 6, 41 and 42 says, "Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Brother, let me take the speck out of your eye,' when you yourself fail to see the plank in your own? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." And again, how accurate is that, you know? We can see tiny little faults in some people, can't we? But we forget to see the big faults in our own lives. The woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, drawing water from the well, encountered Jesus, didn't she? And John 4:7-26 reads, "When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, 'Will you give me a drink?' His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, 'You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?' For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water running up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on the mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will follow and worship the Father in the spirit and in truth, for they are kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one you speak to, am he." The woman was in the right place at the right time. You know, we all think, it's got to be this amazing encounter. But you know, it can be you giving somebody that tiny sip of water. That is an encounter. We don't know who we're serving. We don't know who's asking us for something. You know, have they been sent by Jesus? We don't know. But we do know that we should be feeding those that have nothing. We should be giving those to drink that have nothing. But we cannot give them the everlasting water. Only Jesus can do that. He can give us water of life. And then we move on to a woman who touched the hem of his garment. And I'll read to you in a minute, Matthew 9, verses 20-22. But when I think about it, he knew that that woman had touched him. She didn't touch him on his body, she touched his clothes. So what he felt depart from him was her faith in him. And it says, just then, a woman who had been subjected to bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, if only I can touch his cloak, I will be healed. Gosh, what faith is that? Jesus turned and saw her. Take heart, daughter, he said. Your faith has healed you. And the woman was healed at that moment. She was in the right place, at the right time. But her faith was definitely a huge factor, and Jesus knew this as he felt power in his body. Right place, right time. All these people that I talked to you about this morning were in the right place at the right time. Who was the common denominator? Jesus. Surely right time, right place is all down to the love, power and blessing of the I Am. He's with you always, and therefore right time, right place is a constant. It's not a coincidence. You know, and I think sometimes we think, oh yeah, you know, let's go and we've just done this and we've just done that. But if something is going to happen to you that is supernatural, God has planned that. We know that God knows the end from the beginning, not the beginning from the end. You know, and right time, right place. When God comes back, it will be the right time and the right place. And only he knows when that is. You know, all these silly people that say, oh, you know, the end of the world is going to happen on this day, on this year. What a load of baloney. It's rubbish. Only God knows. Only God knows the end from the beginning. Not the beginning, from the end. He knows your whole life story. You can't hide anything from him. Right time, right place. Not a coincidence. Always a constant in our lives with God. This came from something that my son-in-law had written quite a while ago. He wrote something about right time, right place. And it really spoke to me at the time because I was going through quite a lot in work. And most of you know that I teach, and I teach adults with learning difficulties. And I was going through quite a traumatic experience in my life. And my son-in-law said these words, and they were quite amazing at the time. They were poignant for me, they helped me, and I'm sure that they helped anybody else that had read them. And part of what he wrote was, don't let those mistakes of your past rob you of the best that is yet to come. You might be astounded by what happens. Restoration arrives, just the right place. Just the right time. You know, and when we talk about restoration, what does restoration mean? It's giving us a second chance, isn't it? You know, it's a time where we can heal rifts, where we can heal broken hearts. And as Andrea was praying this morning, I was thinking about, you know, yes, she's praying for the dad, she's praying for the mums. But when we talk about mums, I know that there are mothers that have got, they've got problems because their kids don't talk to them. They've got hurts because their kids don't talk to them. And, you know, I'm blessed. I've got a daughter that talks to me every day. I can't get away from that. I'm afraid not to, yeah. You know, but I've also got a granddaughter that speaks to me nearly every day as well, you know, and I'm blessed. I know that Sheila's blessed. She's got two girls. She's now got a granddaughter too. You know, and Arlette is blessed. Carol's blessed. Ninette is blessed. We've got children, you know. Mabusi is blessed. She's got two beautiful boys, you know. And we are blessed because we are mothers, you know. And sometimes we think, yeah, we're right place, right time. You know, we've caught this happening and we've caught that happening. But God is always present. We can't always be present. And Andrea, I'm sorry I missed you out. You've got a beautiful daughter. And, you know, it's just like people think, oh, you've got no children. How can you be a mother? You can be a mother. You can be a mother. I have only one daughter, but I have mothered 80 other children. When we fostered, I fostered 80 kids, you know, and one of those keeps coming back time after time after time. I'm still his mum, and my husband is still his dad, you know, and this is 20 odd years. And the amazing thing, he's also a Christian, and he works very closely within the Christian society. And that to me is a real blessing. If only one of the children that I ever fostered became a Christian, I did my job, you know? So yeah, right time, right place. It's really important to remember. It's not a coincidence when God is there. It's a constant. He's a constant in your life. And don't forget that. He's your mother, he's your father, he's your friend. You know, it's not like having to ring the king now and say, oh, have you got time for a chat? God is constant, he's there. It doesn't matter what time, what day, what hour, what minute, what second, he's there. You know, he's a constant in our lives. Andrea, I wonder if you could play the song I've asked for just for a minute, please.
It's the right place and the right time.
Those who are wondering when is the good time happening, let's just pray that they walk into a season of, oh, it happens, good time. Coincidences? No, God's time.
Yeah, okay. I've just been asked to pray, and I want to pray that anybody watching this, anybody at all, you know, it's not a coincidence when you meet God. It's a constant. God is there for you whenever you need him, no matter what the reason. Whether or not you feel lonely, whether you feel bereft of something, whether you're struggling with mental health, whether you're struggling financially, it doesn't really matter what it is. God is there, and God will be a constant in your life. Just allow him to give you everything that you need. All you have to do is open your mouth and ask. That's it. It's as simple as that. Dear God, and pour out your heart. God is listening. God is waiting. God wants to be a constant in your life. Amen.